product in the past is acquired taste. Some people have gone too far in enjoying sin, that their taste for sin has is acquired now, and the ordinary wholesome healthy things which appear to be wholesome and healthy would appear to them, such people, insipid and meaningless. So you think that what is attractive to your taste, if you convey it to him, he would immediately start biting, while in fact whatever you produce is simply a boredom, a complete lack of interest. They say, I am not interested, leave it alone. So try to understand his interest. For instance, I am elaborating on this one particular point now to illustrate the whole thing. And by understanding the interests, you can follow certain aspects of interests which are common with Islam, or with common with at least some factors, where you can ultimately make him moving in that direction and gradually change the course later on. So it's a very highly developed art which can be learned through practice, through experience. But initially some people are gifted with this art and some are not. So, as far as this art of approach is concerned, this has to be learned through experience, and you have different starting points. Some people would start from 100 yards, and some would start from one yard, and so on. But ultimately they will make some advances. But here too, the prayer is a very useful factor. Even if you don't understand a person, if you are insistent and you pray to Allah that I am trying my best and I don't know what sort of man he is and how I can make him interested in Islam, so you help me, then what you will think as a chance, something would happen by that apparent chance, that you will strike just the right point, not through understanding but through Allah's guidance in fact. And suddenly the key would be turned, the locks would be opened. So prayer is highly essential here too, and this is how it mingles with the factors. Once I was told by a Mullah Naqshbandi, for instance, I used to listen with great interest to their various experiences, and I found it, I mean I knew it before, but I was doubly reassured that this was true, that those Mawlamin who had the habit of praying, they were much more successful despite the lack of knowledge as compared to other knowledgeable Mawlamin who did not who were not accustomed to pray as humbly as they did. I mean, this was generally my impression about them, and I was surprised to find how the conversions were made by these ordinary, almost ignorant Mawlamin Naqshbandi who had very low level of knowledge, just primary pass or primary fail and things. Previously we used to take Mawlamin or even that standard, but highly effective in preaching, in true conversions. So one of them, for instance, told me a very interesting incident. He went to a village and tried to preach Ahmadiyyat, and the Maulvi there was so adamant, he first called him bad names, and then he said, look here, would you listen to me or would you understand the language of chitar, that is the shoes. So he wanted to spend the night there. He said, oh, look here, get out of this village and you'll be beaten to a mesh if you, I mean, what you called, that is, you'll be meshed by beating if you don't listen. So actually he was beaten and turned out of the village. So he prayed to Allah and he said, Allah, open some way for me to make this Maulvi understand. This is my desire, I want to convert this Maulvi. So next time he visited the same village, he was prepared for all the beating and everything. And he reached there at a time when people were taking the corpse of somebody who had died for the burial. And the mullah was leading the processions, he also quietly joined, and because it was such a time that people generally don't beat others, you know, at that time. So their crestfallen means, you know, stricken by sorrow or somewhere, at least making it appear that they were deeply stricken by sorrow. So that was, the procession was in a very somber mood. So he also joined that. Now, he started watching what happened. The Maulvis generally give a hand, helping hand to the corpse when it is buried, when it is conveyed down to Lahad. That, you know, that pit, special pit which is called Lahad. So while the Maulvi was doing this, suddenly, you know, he had a brainwave. He said, this is the time to convey Ahmadiyyat to him. Now he's extremely afraid. So he bent down, caught the Maulvi by the neck, just like this, and said, look here Maulvi, before you lay down the bed, I want to talk to you. Tell me, will this man ever return? Or he is gone forever? The Maulvi said, no, he will never return, he is gone forever. He said, so will you, I assure you. And when Allah asked you at that time whether you had received the message of Ahmadiyyat or not, and how did you treat it, then you can imagine what may happen to you if Ahmadiyyat is true. Now it's up to you, that's all I had to say. Now that day the Maulvi didn't turn him out of the village. He was, you know, a very deeply worried man. And at night while he was sleeping in the same village in the mosque, the same Maulvi came rushing to the mosque, woke him up and said, accept my Ahmadiyyat today, now, here. I don't want any delay. So what has happened? He said, don't ask me this. First accept Ahmadiyyat, tell me how to accept Ahmadiyyat and get me initiated, and then I'll tell the story. So he said, all right, he accepted. And then the Maulvi told that I saw a very terrible dream. Exactly the same thing which you were telling me did happen in my dream. And I was about to be beaten thoroughly by angels of hell and shoved into hell, when I said, no God, let me go back. And then my eyes opened and I immediately thought of you and rushed to you. So that was just a miracle of prayer. There was no conviction involved through logic or by any other means, or even such a dream could have been interpreted differently by a person. Ordinarily he would have said, because this, he had talked to me like this, so it was a psychological affair. Naturally I was under impression because of that particular time and particular hour, and my own mind has created this scene for me. He could have interpreted like this. People are known to have done that. But because it was organized by Allah, so the effect was also produced. And that Maulvi, which I'm telling you about, was no ordinary Ahmadi. He was immediately removed from his service, he was debased, he was put to all sort of tortures, and he had no means of livelihood left to him. We offered help to him financially, he refused. He had some money, he became a vendor of small things, and remained in the same valley, village, earned his own livelihood, and that was the quality of his Ahmadiyyat. So prayer is highly essential. You can't underrate the prayer, however much you lay the stress on this aspect, still you will not be able to do justice to this. So all those who preach, if they continuously pray and meaningfully and sincerely with all their heart in the prayer, then great miracles will begin to appear here and there, right and left. Yes, please. Have you come? When? How could we miss you coming all the way from there to here?